Welcome to Aetcm, the emergency medicine channel. Today we are going to discuss about the classification of arthritis. You may be knowing that arthritis means inflammation of joint. There are two terminologies you should understand: arthralgia and arthritis. Arthritis means it is an inflammation of joint. You can have swelling, pain, tenderness, redness all around the joint. Arthralgia means only pain, there is no signs of inflammation. Okay, so there is a difference between arthritis and arthralgia. If a patient complains about arthritis or arthralgia, initially we have to examine the patient and find out whether it's an arthritis or arthralgia. Once you diagnose it is an arthritis on the basis of inflammatory signs on the area of joint, then you should classify the joint disease according to the following protocol. I'll be discussing about the classification of arthritis with a simple chart. So we'll see what is an arthritis, what are the features of different type of arthritis. So I am getting a patient of arthritis now. So I have to classify this arthritis according to the following chart, so that it will be very easy to make a diagnosis. So first we'll see there are two major type of arthritis. There is monoarthritis. Monoarthritis means only one joint is involved. Then another one is polyarthritis. Okay, so the major classification starts here: monoarthritis and polyarthritis. Mono means only one joint is involved. Now we'll see the examples of monoarthritis articular involvement. It can be trauma. It can be osteoarthritis, it can be gout. Rarely psoriasis can be there. Okay, trauma means there is an history of accident or injury to the joint. After the injury, slowly the joint becomes swollen and it is painful. Okay, so there is a history of trauma there, okay, history of accident there. So trauma can produce monoarticular joint involvement. Next we'll see osteoarthritis. Osteoarthritis is a degenerative type of arthritis. Normally it occurs in an elderly individual, or rarely it can be due to a secondary change occurring in a inflammatory arthritis like rheumatoid arthritis or SLE. You can get a secondary osteoarthritis, but normally in an elderly patient who can have joint diseases, that is called as degenerative arthritis, mainly in the lower limbs. It classically is seen in the knee joint or ankle joint. Rarely it can be seen in the hip joint, but classically it is in the knee joint. So knee joint, when you have arthritis, you have to examine. When you examine the joint, you can see there will be some swelling. There may not be signs of inflammation, but rarely you can have secondary infection. But normally there may be swelling, there may be signs of pain, all these things. When you examine the joint, you keep the hand on the knee joint, ask the patient to move the limb up and down, you can get crepitus. Okay, so it's a degenerative arthritis. There is a cushion in between two major bones. That cushion has lost its water content and bones will rub each other. Okay, so you get crepitus when you move the lower limb. Okay, so knee osteoarthritis is a classical arthritis we are discussing now. It's a degenerative arthritis. It can occur in the one knee joint or both knee joints simultaneously. When you examine, you get crepitus. Then when you take an x-ray, you can see the knee joint spaces diminished. Okay, there is no much investigation other than x-ray in this knee joint arthritis. You can take an x-ray. Once you make a clinical diagnosis of knee joint arthritis, physiotherapy is the best modality of treatment in osteoarthritis. Physiotherapy can improve the muscle strength around the knee joint and it can improve the symptoms. Okay, the only drug which has proven treatment is diacerin. So diacerin is the drug which can have some effect on this osteoarthritis. You can give 50 milligram TID, that can be given. Okay, now you take gout. Okay, gout is classically present as monoarticular joint inflammation. Very classically it occurs in the lower limb, in the first metatarsophalangeal joint, that is your great toe, at the it is on the base of the great toe. Suddenly patient get severe pain, tenderness, redness, all these things, unable to walk. Okay, all these acute inflammatory signs will be there in the gouty arthritis. It's classically seen in first metatarsophalangeal joint, and it is an acute onset disease. Patient can have previous history of the same problem. Rarely other joints can be involved. Okay, if you see the uric acid on acute phase, it may be negative. Okay, but if you follow up this patient's uric acid can be elevated during normal phase also. In acute phase, it may be normal or reduced. Very rarely it can be increased. Okay, and the treatment, you can see if the patient is having acute gout, you have to start colchicine. That is a treatment. You can give NSAIDs, you can give steroids if the symptoms are very, very severe. But classically, the treatment for acute gout is colchicine, 0.5 milligram. You can give 3 times or 4 times daily. And once the inflammation sets in, you have to go for drugs like febuxostat. You can start febuxostat 40 to 80 milligram OD or BD in gouty arthritis. And they have to follow up the diet plan to reduce the uric acid levels in the blood. Okay, so gouty arthritis classically occurs in the first metatarsophalangeal joint. It can occur in any joint, but classically it is in the lower limb, first metatarsophalangeal joint. Uric acid may or may not be elevated in acute phase. You have to start the patient on colchicine 0.5 milligram TID. Later you can switch the patient to febuxostat. That is an ideal drug in follow-up. Febuxostat 40 to 80 milligram to be continued for a long period. Patient has to go for a diet restriction. Psoriasis will not be discussing now. These are the first major arthritis we have discussed. It can be a monoarticular joint involvement can be due to trauma. Osteoarthritis, degenerative arthritis, treatment options are very limited. Diacetin is the only drug which is proven to be beneficial in osteoarthritis. Gouty arthritis is due to high uric acid and deposition of uric acid in the joint. It is classically seen in first metatarsophalangeal joint. Treatment in acute phase is colchicine. Chronically, you have to follow up this patient with febuxostat. Now we'll go to polyarticular joint. In polyarticular joint involvement, you have two classification. One is deforming, other one is non-deforming. So when our patient have a multiple joint involvement, ask the patient whether it's a deforming. So examine the patient and see, find it's a, there are some deformity is there or not. If there is deformity, it comes to this side. There is no deformity, it go to the opposite side. We'll see the deforming arthritis. What are the two types of deforming arthritis? The classical deforming arthritis is rheumatoid arthritis. Second one is that we'll discuss afterwards. The classical example we'll discuss first. That is rheumatoid arthritis. Another one is ankylosing spondylitis and related arthritis. First we'll discuss about rheumatoid arthritis. Patient has got polyarthritis. There is deformity. There is a chance for deformity. Rheumatoid arthritis we'll discuss. Rheumatoid arthritis is classically present with symmetrical joint involvement, small joint involvement, hand joint involvement. Commonest joint involved is proximal interphalangeal joint. Deformity is present. So rheumatoid arthritis is a chronic type of inflammatory arthritis wherein you have symmetrical involvement of your hand. The patient can have symmetrical involvement of proximal interphalangeal joint, metacarpophalangeal joint, wrist joint. Large joints are classically not involved, but rarely it can be involved. Rarely patient can present with monoarticular joint involvement also. But in a normal settings, polyarticular involvement, deformity is classical, symmetrical joint involvement, small joint involvement, hand joint involvement, proximal interphalangeal joint involvement is a classical finding. Now we'll see what is the investigation required in this. Rheumatoid factor is one investigation which can tell you whether arthritis is there or not. But the problem with rheumatoid arthritis is many patients who is having joint pain without rheumatoid arthritis, this can be falsely positive. So it's not a very good investigation, but it can be positive. If it is positive, you can call it as RA rheumatoid factor positive rheumatoid arthritis. If it is negative, you can call it as rheumatoid factor negative rheumatoid arthritis. Another investigation is anti-cyclical citrullinated peptide, ACCP. So this investigation is very classically positive for rheumatoid arthritis. It can even positive before the onset of rheumatoid arthritis. So it's a very good investigation to be done in rheumatoid arthritis. So rheumatoid arthritis is a polyarticular, deforming, symmetrical, small joint involvement arthritis. Predominantly hand joints are involved, proximal interphalangeal joints are involved. Rheumatoid factor may or may not be positive. Anti-cyclical citrullinated peptide is a classical investigation which may be positive in rheumatoid arthritis. Treatment we will not be discussing now, but I'll just tell you there is one type of treatment, that is steroid, and another type of treatment is steroid sparing agents. Okay, so steroids classically started because a patient is having acute arthritis. If you don't give a faster treatment, joint may be damaged. So immediately after seeing the patient, we can start him on steroids, like you can start Vicylon 1 milligram per kg body, that may be around 40 to 60 milligram per day to be started. And you can start steroid sparing agents or DMRDs, disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drugs, like hydroxychloroquine sulfate, methotrexate, sulfasalazine. These drugs are called as steroid sparing agents. So initially you start with steroid and switch to methotrexate or hydroxychloroquine sulfate. And patient may require long-term follow-up, and patient can have repeated exacerbation. So rheumatoid arthritis we have discussed. It's a polyarticular, deforming arthritis, symmetrical arthritis, mainly the small joints of hand, proximal interphalangeal joints are classically involved. Rheumatoid factor can be positive, may or may not be positive. Anti-CCP is a investigation which is definitely positive in rheumatoid arthritis. Treatment is steroid or steroid sparing agents. And biologicals are another type of steroid sparing agents that also can be used here. We will not be discussing that now. We will go to ankylosing spondylitis. What is the difference between rheumatoid arthritis and ankylosing spondylitis? It's a polyarticular involvement. It's a deforming arthritis, but from here onwards it is different. It is not symmetrical. It is asymmetrical. Small joints are not classically involvement. Large joints are involvement. Okay. Hand is never involved. Very rarely hand is involved. It classically involves the spine and lower spine, lumbar spine and sacroiliac joint. So lumbosacral spine is classically involved, but rarely it can involve the peripheral joints. That is, asymmetrically large joints in lower limbs are involved. It is symmetrical small joint, hand joints are involved. Here asymmetrical large joints and in the lower limb sacroiliac joints are classically involved. There is no classical investigation for this one which can predict the ankylosing spondylosis, but you can take an X-ray, CT, MRI of spine. All these things will tell you the changes in the spine and joints that can be done. Treatment is almost similar as rheumatoid arthritis. You can use steroids, steroid sparing agents, or you can use biologicals, but physiotherapy has got a major role in ankylosing spondylitis. And HLA-B27 can be positive in many cases. Okay, so ankylosing spondylitis and related arthritis, there are a lot of related arthritis which can present like ankylosing spondylitis. So that they can have asymmetrical arthritis, long joints are involved, lumbosacral spine is involved, sacroiliac joint is involved, HLA-B27 may be positive, steroid sparing agents, biological steroid sparing agents, physiotherapy is the classical treatment protocol. Now we'll go to non-deforming arthritis. We'll see what are the non-deforming arthritis. Normally when you have arthritis, if it is producing deformity, you call it as deforming arthritis. If it does not produce deformity, that is non-deforming arthritis. We'll see the classical example, that is SLE. You all may be knowing that SLE is classically a skin disease. Very rarely it can produce joint involvement. So SLE can involve joints, but patient can have arthritis, patient can have skin involvement, patient can have involvement on the multi-system involvement can be there, like heart, liver, kidney, everything can be involved, but rarely it can involve even the joints, but they are not deforming arthritis. Another one is rheumatic heart disease. This is due to streptococci. It involves the heart. It can involve the peripheral joints. It can involve the large joints, like you can have knee joint effusion. It's a fleeting type of arthritis. Today, right knee joint may be involved. After 1 week, left knee joint may be involved. Then elbow may be involved. It is a fleeting type of arthritis, and it completely recovers after the treatment. There will not be any deformity in the rheumatic heart disease induced arthritis. So we have discussed about different approach towards different type of arthritis. I have not discussed about the treatment in detail, but it's only a classical approach. Arthritis divide whether it's a monoarticular joint or polyarticular joint. Then ask the history of trauma. If there is no history of trauma, if it is knee joint, old age, think about osteoarthritis, take an X-ray. Diazepam may be helpful. If the patient is taking alcohol or increased non-vegetarian diet, gout is a possibility. It involves classically the first metatarsophalangeal joint. Uric acid may or may not be elevated. The classical treatment for acute gout is colchicine, then switch to febuxostat. Psoriasis is something like ankylosing spondylitis. It involves all joints. It's a asymmetrical peripheral arthritis. Lumbosacral joint can be involved. Fingers can be involved. Very rarely it can present like a monoarticular joint, but not a classical example. Now go to polyarthritis. Somebody is saying multiple joint involvement. Examine the patient for deformity. Initially you may not get deformity, but later you get a deformity. If it is deforming arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis is a classical example. If it's a non-deforming arthritis, SLE, rheumatic heart disease is classically. Rheumatoid arthritis, you get symmetrical arthritis, small joint involvement, hand joint involvement, proximal interphalangeal joint involvement. Whereas psoriatic arthritis, distal interphalangeal joint will be involved. Osteoarthritis, distal interphalangeal joint will be involved. But rheumatoid arthritis, classically proximal interphalangeal joint. Rheumatoid factor may or may not be positive. If it is positive, you call it as RA, rheumatoid factor positive RA. Anti-cyclical citrullinated peptide can be positive in most of the rheumatoid arthritis. Treatment is steroid sparing agents or biological steroid sparing agents like rituximab. Now, ankylosing spondylitis and related arthritis including psoriasis, asymmetrical, large joint involvement, lumbosacral spine involvement. Remember, RA will never involve lumbosacral spine. Rarely, cervical spine can be involved. Then, you can have HLA B27 in some patients. Treatment is almost like rheumatoid arthritis nowadays. Physiotherapy has got a major role. Polyarthritis, non-deforming, SLE is classical example. Multiple joints are involved. Skin may be involved, but rarely it produces deformity. Rheumatic heart disease with streptococcal infection can have joint involvement, fleeting joint involvement, never produces any deformity. So we have discussed about an approach towards arthritis, poly and mono. Thank you.